Okay, I think it is now recording. So, is the screen still visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so I'll just start with this slide again. So, this slide basically tells us about evolution of the engineering materials. So, what is meant by this, that how the importance of these materials, it changed with the progress in the human civilization. So, it basically what tells it tells us that different ages are being classified on the top, like Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, Age of Steel, Polymer, Silicon, and then we have this last one, that is the Age of Molecular Engineering. So what has happened is that again the classification is still, the broad classification is same as discussed in the previous slide. We have metals, we have polymers and elastomers, we have composites, we have ceramics and glass. So if you see here in the 10,000 BC around, so we had less emphasis, the metals were less discovered, so the emphasis was less. So we had mostly copper, gold. Then we had wood, skin, fibers. Those came in the category of polymers. Then composites, we had straw and brick. So almost in the 10,000 BC, there were composites. Then if you talk of ceramics and glasses, we had stone, flint, pottery, and all these type of materials with which the initial human civilization, they used to make their utensils, then weapons, houses, their clothing to wear, okay, and then some rare metals also were there. And as we progressed in this ages, through Bronze Age, Iron Age, the relative importance of metals, it started to increase. So here copper was discovered, bronze, iron, similarly cast iron. At the same time, there were new polymers discovered like glues and all. And lastly, we have here in the ceramic section, cement was there. So now we have almost came to this 1000 AD. So AD starts here. And as we move ahead in the age of steel, so we had steel which was discovered, then we had rubber in form of polymers, refractories, Portland cement and all. So what you will observe that in this era, starting here, this era is a very important era for the human civilization. So there is a maximum emphasis on the metals. So basically what this era had in it had the First World War, the Second World War, and to some extent the Cold War. So these world wars, basically during the era of World War, lot of metals, new metals, alloys, they were developed, super alloys were developed, and the emphasis on metal, it got increased. Even till date, you observe around yourself, many of the products, they still use metal in some form or the other. So there was less emphasis, and during this time, on polymers or elastomers, very less on composites. And there were some ceramics, like in form of cement, pyroceramics, etc., which were used. As we move ahead from the Cold War era, yeah, some mic is unmuted, kindly mute. Kindly mute yourself. Kindly mute. Who is there? Yeah, okay, fine. So, as we move ahead from this Cold War era, so what was developed after that was these type of advanced composites like GFRP was there. So what is GFRP? GFRP basically stands for glass fiber reinforced plastics. Then CFRP is there. This is carbon fiber reinforced plastic. Then Kevlar is there. This is Kevlar fiber reinforced plastic. FRP stands for fiber reinforced plastic. Then we had this metal matrix composites, ceramic composites. So these ages, over the ages, we moved to from polymers. So lot of new polymers were developed. So these polymers like high modulus polymers, high temperature polymers, all these were developed. At the same time, new metallic materials in form of glassy metals, aluminium lithium alloys, dual phase steels, new alloys, they were also developed. But mostly the focus was on quality control in these types of metals. So as such, innovation in metal, it started reducing, and innovation in other type of materials like polymers, composites, ceramics, they started to increase. So that is how the complete picture, how the materials around us, they have evolved with the need, is basically summarized using this diagram. Now we move ahead to the modern classification of the engineering materials. Today, if you see that we classify materials in these six categories, which also includes the traditional categories like metal, polymer, ceramic, glasses, elastomers. And we have this new category coming in, the hybrids. So what are hybrids? So hybrids are basically materials which are formed by combining, say, two of these or maybe more. So at least two of these materials, if they combine, they give a hybrid. So hybrid materials, they generally have very different properties than their constituent counterparts. So we will discuss more about these type of materials in the subsequent slides. So any product you look around yourself will have the material which will be falling in one of these categories. Now, what we are going to do is we are going to discuss in bit detail each one of these with their special properties and applications, in which application which material is used. And by the end of this part, you will be able to appreciate why a specific material is more popular in a specific application. So we'll start with the first one, which is the metals. So metals are basically, as I showed in the how the materials have evolved. So metals are a very special class of materials which we see around ourselves. And mostly, if you see, more than 70% of applications, they use metals. So metals are this material which, when freshly prepared, they basically exhibit a very lustrous appearance, and they are also have this ability to conduct electricity and heat very effectively. So typically all the materials are malleable. So you have to understand this term malleable. So malleable is basically indicating that the ability of the metal to be hammered into thin sheets. And at the same time, the metal is also ductile, means it can be drawn into wires. So different chemical elements are there which come in the category of metals, like iron is there, and there are some more metals which come in the category of alloy. So we will see what is an alloy and how it is different than a metal, or what it is, in these next few slides. So before we jump ahead, just take a look at this periodic table. So you are very familiar what is about the periodic table, and what you will observe, more than 85% of the elements in the periodic table, they come in this category of metals. So that's it. That is why these metals are so ubiquitous that we can see them around ourselves. So almost all applications, so you will observe metals are being used. So they have certain distinguishing features about this. First is their atoms, they are arranged in a very regular repeating structure. So how this happens? So when a metal is solidifying, or it is being after getting melted and solidifying, so these atoms, they basically arrange themselves to form the crystals. So we will see in the module of casting how the solidification happens. So these crystals, when they are arranged in a very periodic manner, so they become a crystalline material. So atoms, when they have a very repeated structure, so these metals, they are, because of this repeated structure, they have a very lustrous appearance. And the bonds which are mostly present in the metals are metallic bonds, where the electron in the outermost shell is basically just floating around in the complete system. And that basically helps the metal to conduct heat and electricity very effectively. The next important feature of the metal is relatively good strength. So what is meant by good strength? So first we need to understand what is strength. So strength is basically the ability to bear external loads. So how much load any particular metal can take. So strength is basically quantified in what is the ability of the external material to take external load. And higher is this ability, higher is the strength of the material. So in case of metals, the load bearing capability is quite high compared to polymers, ceramics, and even in some cases then composites also. But there are different types of loads also. So if you talk of loads, so these loads is a very important factor in deciding or selecting any material for a given product. So this load is basically classified as tensile load. It can be compressive load, or it can be a shear load. It can be a fatigue load. It can be a creep load. So these are different type of loading conditions in which a material is subjected. And generally what happens in the most of the products, there is a multiple loads. So means these different type of loads, they act at the same time. So tensile is a load when the load, applied load, basically what happens in the case of tensile load, if you have the sample, sorry. So when the load is basically pulling it apart, so that becomes a tensile load. If this load is basically pushing it together or compressing it, it becomes a compressive load. So this will become the compressive load. In case of shear, what happens? Shear will take a slightly different configuration. So this is the material. If you consider this end to be fixed, you apply the load, the material will get deformed. So this is a kind of a shear loading. And lastly, second last is basically the fatigue load. So what is a fatigue load? So everyone, if you are familiar, you might have broken a wire by, providing it alternatively providing it with compressive load or, tensile load. So fatigue is basically a cyclic load. Cyclic in form of compression or tension. Cyclic load. So this means basically what you are doing is you are giving a alternative kind of a sinusoidal load. And fatigue loading are basically a dynamic loading conditions in which you have a moving parts or there is a motion. And this type of loads, they basically are very important to study because they cause failure of material at a very low level of stress which is generated. I'll discuss what is stress and all. And lastly is the creep load. So creep is basically type of loading in which the value of load is constant, but you have a temperature factor also associated. So you have elevated temperature also. So in all other cases, so what is the condition? That role of temperature is less considered, but in creep is such a case where you have load plus temperature. So these are very complex engineering situations where you have different you should have different type of materials which behave in a predictable manner so that the service life of the product is not affected. So I started with explaining you what is strength. So that is ability to take external load. Then I discussed what are different type of loads. And now we will see what are other property of metals which make them so distinguishable compared to their other material counterparts.
So can you explain that fatigue load again?
Let me complete some slides. I will, in the end, I'll take up all the doubts and explain the things if required again. I'll do that in the end. So please remind me once I complete my things. So move ahead then. So often these metals are quite dense. So dense means how the density comes. It is basically because of the atomic packing. So atomic packing, atoms, how they are packed. So atomic packing is very efficient in case of metals, so that gives them a very high density. But if you consider this density, so it gives another issue with most of the metals, that they are very, you know, heavy. Because if the atoms are very closely packed, so the weight of the material, it increases drastically. So in applications which demand for low weight kind of scenarios, like automobiles, aircraft, so there only specific metals are being used rather than every metal. So generally lightweight metals like aluminium is more popular, is more preferred over other metal like iron. So you can understand aluminium has the atomic number 13, and iron, it is almost double, it is 26. So because of this lower atomic number, so there will be less atoms to be packed. So atoms are also light. And in case of 26, the atoms will be heavier. So that will basically tell us the atomic number basically is a direct correlation, which we can tell is it dense, going to be dense or not. Then malleable or ductile, that I already discussed. Malleable means ability of the metal to be hammered into sheets. And ductile is the ability of the metal to be drawn into wires. So that means they exhibit very high plasticity. Now here is a very important term which is coming in, which is telling us about plasticity. We'll discuss something about this in this slide itself. So every metal, it has two important properties. One is the elasticity, another is the plasticity. So I'll explain what is plasticity, what is elasticity. So if you take if you have studied in school, this is from the mechanics of solid. So what happens, you have the load displacement curve. So you plot this load displacement curve. So what you do is you go on increasing the load. So what will happen within a certain limit, suppose this limit, you remove the load, the material, it will come back to its original state. So this region where until which it does so is known as the elastic region. And if you increase the load beyond this limit, that is the elastic limit, and you increase the load, and when you will leave the load, it will not come back to its original position. Rather, there will be some permanent deformation which will be brought into this metal. So what is this region beyond this elastic limit is known as the plastic region. So all these metals, basically what they do is they are having very large plastic regions, means they have this ability to take the plastic deformation to a larger extent before they actually fracture. So what happens, the complete ability of the material to absorb this energy before fracture, so this the area under this load displacement curve, it gives the total energy which is basically absorbed by the energy by the material before fracture. So this is known as the toughness. So toughness is a very important property in most of the metals, that is the ability to absorb the energy. Now I will give you an example in this case. So you have a tumbler which is made up of steel and a tumbler which is made up of glass. Now if you drop both the tumblers, say from a height, so what will happen? The tumbler which is made up of steel, it will not fracture into pieces, but the tumbler which is made up of glass will immediately fracture into pieces. Now what is the difference? So basically I am comparing steel with glass. Now steel, it is basically a metallic alloy which is having a dominant percentage of iron and a very small percentage of carbon. So this basically has the ability to absorb the energy. So what is happening when you are dropping this tumbler? So this tumbler is being dropped, you're dropping it. So what is happening, that the energy, kinetic energy with which it is being dropped is basically after impact with the ground, it is being absorbed by this tumbler. So it is, since it is absorbing, so the toughness is higher. But at the same time, if you take the example of this glass, so this tumbler is going to fracture into pieces. So you are going to get it will shatter into pieces. because glass it is a ceramic. So ceramics generally they have very poor toughness. So means upon impact they cannot absorb the energy. So what happens, instead of absorbing, they just break into pieces. Now this is a very important property if you look it from another perspective. Say I'll give you example of automobile. So now in automobiles, what happens, all the body of the automobile, of a car, they are made up of some metallic sheet. Maybe it is steel or aluminium in different cases. But we never have the any ceramic material which is there on the sheet of the body of the vehicle. So why this happens? Now in case there is an impact, so what will happen, if you have the sheet which is made up of any ceramic material, so the energy upon impact will not be absorbed by the ceramic. Instead, the whole of the energy, it will be basically transferred inside to the passenger. But if it is a case of a metallic sheet, so generally what will happen, the metal will not break into pieces, but it will get deformed, means it will enter this plastic region upon impact. Thereby, it absorbs a lot of energy, thus preventing the energy to get transferred inside the passenger cabin and saving many, many lives. So that is why these are like two very examples, very daily life kind of examples, where you can appreciate this property of toughness in different metals. So I have discussed like two properties with you. One is strength, that is ability to take external load. And second property is toughness, is the ability to absorb energy upon impact. So both of these properties are quite high in case of metals. So now we move ahead with more properties of metals. That is excellent conductors of heat and electricity. So as I mentioned, so in most of the metals, we have metallic bonds in which the electrons, you know, outer shell electrons, they are mostly floating in the sea of ions. And this kind of arrangement gives a very high value of electrical and heat conductivity. So mostly in any conductor of heat and electricity will be definitely made up of a metal. Then opaque to visible light. So this opaque to visible light is basically correlated again to the dense structure. Means light, since it has a very dense structure, which are very closely packed atoms. So generally light, visible light, at least it cannot penetrate through the metal. So they are very opaque to visible light. But if I change the wavelength to a shorter wavelength, say I move to the X-rays, or I move to the X-rays, for example, I'll take example of X-rays. So now you know that X-rays, they are having a shorter wavelength. So lambda for X-ray is shorter than lambda of the visible light. So generally what you will observe, especially at an airport, so these X-rays are largely used to scan your luggage to see what is inside. So because X-rays, since having shorter wavelength, higher energy, so they can penetrate through the dense structure of metals, but visible light cannot penetrate through it because of the low energy. Then next is the shiny appearance. So that I've already discussed, because of the periodic arrangement of the atoms. So the metals, especially when freshly cut, they exhibit a very lustrous appearance. Then next property of the metals is basically to form these cations through electron loss. So what is this? This is a very important thing to understand, that most of the metals, they are quite reactive to oxygen. And especially this reaction accelerates in presence of moisture, which we manifest in the form of corrosion. So many metals, they corrode. So some metals, they corrode in a very different way, like you have iron. So iron, basically, it forms upon a corrosion, it forms the iron oxide. And this basically is a brown color flaky material, which basically causes loss of material. Then also we have some other metals like aluminium. It forms aluminium oxide. Plus aluminium oxide is a very good adhering oxide layer on the aluminium, which protects it from further corrosion. So in some cases, the oxide layer is helpful. In most cases, it is not helpful. And corrosion is such a phenomena which causes billions of dollars or rupees of it goes in loss because of corrosion. So most of the metals, they are prone to corrosion. So often you will find metallic structure being painted, so their surface is functionally modified, painted to avoid this contact with oxygen or moisture to prevent corrosion. And at the same time, painting also gives an aesthetic appeal to most of the products. And lastly, almost in this regard, is recyclability. So recyclability of metal is a very important property, which makes us, almost at a very safe side, that once a metal is basically, product is created out of metal, once the service life of the product is complete, so at the end, what we do is we recycle that metal from the product to make new products. So that is why what you do is you don't just dispose of metal, but you send it to a recycling agency or a recycling plant where they, disintegrate the product. They recover different parts which are made up of specific metals, like if a part is having aluminium, copper, or iron. So what they will do is they will just segregate the parts as per their material specification. Like aluminium will go to aluminium bin. You have copper, which will go to the copper bin. You will have iron, which will go to the iron bin. And then what you will do, basically all those parts will be recycled, means you will again melt them to create new products and which can be used again. So recyclability is a very important property of the metals, which helps us to reuse them again and again. Because what you have to understand here is that we have a limited or a finite supply of these metals on the crust of the earth. At the crust of the earth, it has finite quantity of it. So recycling of metals is very important from that perspective. And we have developed technology which can do this efficiently for us. So these are some of the basic distinguishing features of the metals. And now I'll discuss some potential applications, although these are some representative applications for metals. First is electrical wiring. Now, as I already discussed, metals are good conductors of heat and electricity. So most of the electrical wiring that you see around yourself, it is made up of either aluminium or it is made up of copper. Then you have bridges, structures, buildings, all these again made up of metals, ability to absorb shocks, energy. Automobile, body, chassis, spring, engine block, all these are made up of metals. Airplane parts, fuselage, landing gear, where you have the dynamic kind of loading conditions, fatigue loading conditions are there. Trains, machine tools, all the hammers, screwdrivers, saws, blades, drilling bits you see are made up of metals. Magnets. So these are some photographs of, representative photographs of some applications. So what I just want to conclude from this slide is that more than 70% of the applications till date, they have metal as the material to go forward to make any product. So most, I can say that 70% or 60% of this course will deal with technologies which encompass metal as the material of consideration to make different products. We will have less emphasis, maybe we won't be discussing too much about technologies which will be, dealing with other set of materials like polymers or maybe ceramics. So polymers I will discuss to a larger extent, but ceramics will be very less because most of the applications are dealing with metals. So these are some more photographs of the potential applications of these metals. Now we move ahead with this. There is classification of these metals also. So metals, as I discussed earlier, they are classified as ferrous, non-ferrous metals, and alloys. So ferrous metals, they have appreciable content of iron, and they are magnetic. And non-ferrous materials, so they don't have dominant iron content, or they are also non-magnetic. So then there are different type of metals which are known as refractory metals. So what are refractory metal and alloys? So refractory metals, they are extraordinarily resistant to heat and wear. So here a new term is coming, that is wear. So what is wear? Wear is basically gradual loss of material from two, you know, parts which are in contact. From, I can say, relative moving parts. So how this is? So whenever any two parts, they are basically in contact with each other and are moving. So material will be lost from both of these parts depending on their hardness as well. So generally, if you will observe a thing or a product which is harder, will basically what it will do, it will basically remove material from the relatively softer product. So this gradual loss of material from the one of the surface is known as wear, and these metals, which are known as refractory metals, are very resistant to this wear. Means they do not lose material very quickly, or I can say they are quite hard. So hardness, here a very another term which is coming in, is what is hardness. So often people confuse hardness and strength together, but hardness is basically the ability to resist scratches, or I can say, or you know, plastic indentation. So any material which has the ability to resist the scratches or the plastic indentation is known as a hard material. And we have certain scales like Rockwell scale or Vickers scale, which grade material based on their hardness. So generally, if we have this Mohs scale also, in which we have 0 to 10 rating, in which talc is a material, like the talc which you apply is a fragrant talc, is very soft, comes at 0 Mohs number, and diamond on the other hand is a very hard material, comes at 10. So I hope the hardness is concept is clear. Coming back to refractory metals, so these are basically hard metals which are resistant to heat and wear. They have melting point up beyond 2000 degrees centigrade, means very high melting point is there, and they also exhibit very high hardness at room temperature. So what happens in most of the cases, the hardness of any material, it reduces as the temperature increases. It is similar to what as the material will change the state from solid to liquid with rise in temperature, the atoms or the molecules, they become free to move because of increased energy. So since they are free to move, they don't stay at their respective position. So they overall basically tend to reduce the hardness. But with these refractory metals, the special properties, even at high temperature, they are able to retain their hardness. Then the examples are niobium, molybdenum, tantalum, tungsten, rhenium. So these are some of the examples of the metals which come in this category of refractory metal and alloys. Next, what are alloys? So I have been discussing this term time and again. So what is an alloy? So what is alloy is basically a material with metallic properties, and it consists of two or more elements in which at least one of the element has to be a metal. So an alloy, it may have a fixed composition, or the alloy, it may have variable composition. What is meant by fixed and variable composition? For example, in gold and silver, so gold and silver are two rare and expensive metals which can form alloy with, you know, any quantity which can be freely adjusted with each other. But most of the engineering alloys which are used in engineering application, they form alloy only at a fixed proportion. For example, this titanium silicon, so this will form an alloy only in the fixed proportion. I will take another example which I have been discussing in the previous slide also, steel. Steel is quite a popular material, it is an alloy. So what is steel? Steel is an alloy. Alloy of what? Alloy of iron plus carbon. Now this in this alloy composition we have one metal, that is iron. Another one is not a metal. Carbon is not a metal. It is a non-metallic element. Now this can form steel only when carbon is less than 2%. If carbon percentage it increases more than 2%, so you will not form steel, rather you will form cast iron. Cast iron is also an alloy of iron, but not, it is not steel. So most of these engineering alloys, they are valid only when the composition is fixed. Like in case of steel, I have mentioned the carbon percentage has to be less than 2% to form steel. Beyond 2%, you have the cast iron. So what is the objective to make these kind of alloys? So objective is to basically improve their properties, such as to make them less brittle, more hardness, they should have high strength, and they should be resistant to corrosion, and basically have different type of properties which are not possible with single material. So that is the main objective to form alloys. And metals in most of the applications are used in form, some form or another form of an alloy, rather than in the pure form. So generally alloys exhibit this high strength to weight ratio, which are especially useful in aerospace and automobile kind of applications. So these are some examples of steel I have already discussed, and bronze is there. Bronze is alloy of copper and tin. And then we have another category of alloys which are known as the super alloys. So what are super alloys? So super alloys are basically alloys which consist of up to 10 elements. So like steel, it consists only of two elements. So super alloy is a element is an alloy which may consist of up to 10 elements. Example is Inconel 718. So Inconel 718 is basically name of an alloy which is a nickel iron based alloy in which there are 10 other elements also. So as the name is indicating, super means it will have super properties compared to a generic alloy. Like it will have very high strength, it will have very high hardness, even it at elevated temperature. So all the jet engines which are made, aircraft engines, they are made up of, some parts of them are made up of these super alloys. So the important property is high strength, high hardness, even at elevated temperature. Elevated temperature here, what I mean by elevated temperature is up to 1000 or 1200 degrees in this range. So even in this range, these super alloys, they can basically retain their properties. And in most of the jet engines, especially the air gas turbines, these super alloys are used as the material to make those kind of products. So these are some photographs of the same. Babbitt is another alloy basically made up of tin, antimony and copper used in bearings. This is a photograph of a jet engine. So with this I will end today's lecture, and now I am open to questions. So please feel free to ask questions from whatever we have discussed today.
So please explain.